Hi, this is Charlie Mato-Toyela with Blueberry Flutes. Just wanted to share a very, I guess, important video for you guys today. A lot of people have asked this question. I've answered it several times in other videos. However, we still get the question, so I figure I probably ought to dedicate one video specifically to answering the question of what is the distance between the air supply hole and the sound hole on a Native American flute? And the truth is, I have seen every size and distance you can imagine, both historically and in present day. And in my opinion, I'll have to put my little disclaimer on that. In my opinion, it seems like there's not really a big difference. It seems like, for the most part, there are some fine adjustments that can be done. However, the distance between the two air supply hole and sound hole doesn't really make a big difference as long as you follow certain rules. Now, if you start going another direction, then that can change it. And that is, of course, something I'll mention when we get there, but not something that we're going to talk about today because some things are better left unchanged. So, if you guys will excuse the mess, we have been making flutes like a storm here lately. What we have got is a piece of indigenous river cane here. If you notice, the links are very far apart, which is very nice for making flutes. And what I'm going to do is leave this as a mouthpiece. I'm going to cut it down a little bit here, and then there, and so on, so I can make three flutes out of it to give you three different examples of the air supply and sound hole length and distance. So if you want to take a look at this. We're going to save this little piece here to make some flute blocks out of, which is kind of important when you're making flutes. Today we won't be discussing the distance from here to here, because really, just like the distance I'm going to show you with the sound hole and the air supply holes, it's quite relative and it's really personal preference to a big degree. So we'll go ahead and go take a look in the book and find our schematics and use those to make a flute. Okay, so we're on page 119 of our flute making book, which is, of course, The Art of Native American Flute Making. And we're going to use the schematics for a copy of an original flute is labeled, which is about 3/4 of an inch in diameter. It says it's going to be a B here. We're not shooting for a B today. We're going to make this flute kind of traditionally tuned, although we're going to probably tune them all alike so that you can hear the differences or similarities with flutes that have different types of tracks, different lengths of tracks, and them being very close in sound. So what we're going to use is this B measurement. It says it's a copy. It has roughly 1/4 inch diameter sound holes and air supply hole, and of course fingerings, roughly. You have to start somewhere, and then from there its inside diameter is about 3/4 of an inch. So the first thing we're going to look at, mark my page here, is we're going to look at the inside diameter of these pieces of river cane. I know you've noticed already that they're different lengths, and that's because I haven't cut them yet. I just kind of cut them to fit. The only thing I did cut was the tops, and if you can see that from where you're at there, the tops are about the same length. So you got a mouthpiece that is about the same size. And although this doesn't really matter too much, let me use this ruler here to see. It's about 5 inches long. So we're going to worry about, I guess, the lengths there in a different video. So making a 4-inch long and a 2-inch long, and what happens with the differences between those, which I think you'll probably find is similar to what's going to happen with the differences between what we're doing today. So having said all that stuff, let's take a measurement here really quick. Like, looks like the inside diameter of this guy is roughly 3/4. It's just a dot under, so I mean it's not really much difference than 3/4. Let's see what we got here. About the same. And river cane tapers, so one of these in theory should be a lot smaller. And it's just a little bit smaller. So we've been losing maybe a half a millimeter each time. And I know I go back and forth from metric to standard. You guys will have to forgive me. When you need precision measurements, or if you want to do something that is typical and standard, you have to go one direction or the other. And a lot of times with this, since it ain't rocket science, a lot of times you find that one or the other is just as well. So let's start off by marking these holes. I'll replace my marker with a caliper in there. The first measurement, as you guys have already seen, is from The sound hole to the first fingering is 4 inches. So let's mark each of our flutes. Well, first I guess we should find out where's going to be the fingerings. I like to put the fingerings on the flutes in such a way that they balance. There we go. You have to find your kind of balance point there. There we go. Something like that. There's a kind of a special measurement between where the balance point of the flute is, that is where you hold it and it doesn't roll anymore, and what it looks like when you play it long ways. You don't want a flute that turns sideways and goes like that. So here we are. The first thing I'm going to do is for you guys' benefit, something I don't ever do in a shop, and that is mark the location of the sound hole. And from there, we'll measure 4 inches on each of them. If I can read this wooden ruler. These measurements are all relative. When you're working with a natural material, I'm not certain if you could get a more perfect measurement using any system. You'd really have to fill the flute with liquid to determine how much mass or volume is up inside of here, and it's just not worth it. So that's the first measurement. The next one is going to be 4 3/4. So we're basically 3/4 of an inch further than we were just now. So there's our 4 marker. Whenever you mark something too, whether you have marked it from the top of the ruler to the node of a piece of river cane or the link inside of your flute, or if you've marked it from the sound hole's projected point or where you think it should be, you should always go back, and when you're measuring, if you've moved the ruler, you should always go back and place the fingering, the top fingering, back where it was, because that's what's going to determine how in tune it is, I guess. So let's go to 4 3/4, which is this little dude right here. Okay. I know somebody back there is thinking, well, that sure ain't very perfect. It's not very precise. And then after 4 3/4, forgive me for not picking the book up, is 6.5 inches. So 4 4 3/4, and then 6.5. Boop. 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 And then after 6.5 is 7.5, 8.5, and then roughly the flute needs to be about 12 inches down to the bottom. So 6.5, 7.5, 8.5. Just about an inch apart there. We got 7.5 and 8.5. If you can't see these markings now, they'll probably look a lot better once they are drilled. And I'm going to mark everything at almost 13 inches, which gives us probably just a little bit too much for what we need. And then we're going to drill these guys out and kind of go from there. So next we're going to use the Forstner bit that I always do to mill down the track area, where the block and the track are going to be. And I know a lot of you want to know what size this is. This is 1.5 inches, but does that matter? No. I used to use 1 7/8 for years and years, and there's been times I've used a 2-inch one, and if we're making small flutes, sometimes I use a 3/4 or a 1-inch. Just really, this is very relative. Most of this, once again, ain't rocket science. I'm going to start my hole here in a couple of different places for an obvious reason. Okay. Just go a little deeper. It's probably deep enough on that one. If you notice, my little pilot inside of the Forstner bit under here left a, and I can show you what a pilot is. It's this little point on the end of the Forstner bit there that helps keep everything centered while you're drilling. It makes a nice little hole for you in there. So there's a hole, and this hole we drilled. And this one here, we may do something else with on one of them, especially the one we need the long track on. At this point, I'm going to sand this down. We'll take it over to the burning tools and get started. Okay, so we're going to figure out in a minute what key they're in so that we can try to key them all alike. Probably going to be around B or A. Probably B is what I'm guessing. Right now, you can see that I've cut the ends off of them down here so that they're all about the same length. Here is one of the leftover pieces from the ends, which we're going to use to make the blocks that go on top of the flute here. And we have some varying size. It's kind of visible there, and we will get to making some drastic differences to them in just a second. First thing we're going to do is go ahead and burn out the fingerings just a little bit, just enough so that they're looking a little cleaner, and then we'll go from there. So let's take a look at that. Okay, so I went ahead and tuned each of these flutes, and I'll show you. This one here has the short track, the short distance between the air supply hole and the sound hole. From one edge to the other, we're looking at somewhere around 20 millimeters, which is about 3/4 of an inch, give or take. And really, the track is a short little guy, which is about... looks like about 19 millimeters long, kind of on the short side, which I guess equates to somewhere around 3/8-ish, you know, somewhere in that ballpark. I'm going to go ahead and tie this guy down. I oiled and waxed it too, which is a really great idea. Helps keep the river cane from drying and cracking, as all of you know. I'm sure many of you have seen several of our videos. Let's see, on flute maintenance. Let's move this guy. Slide this one down a little bit. It's been really windy today. You can hear my greenhouse blowing in the wind over there. So, there we go. Don't ever put the leather in your mouth. That's a bad idea. A lot of Indian people used to chew rawhide and turn it into leather. I don't think that that is a technique which is still being used today very often. So there's one. We'll play it in just a minute, but before we do, I'm going to mark it so we know which one is which. We've got a short, a medium, and a long distance between the air supply hole and the sound hole. This one's the short one. I'm going to put a little marker right there, and we'll lay him down. Beautiful little river cane flute. This one is the medium, and the distance from one sound hole to the next is a little over an inch, about an inch and an eighth. Actually, an inch and a sixteenth, I'm sorry. And the distance of the actual track itself is about 12 millimeters, so we're looking at right near the halfway marker of an inch. Let's go ahead and tie this guy down. Oops. I made my blocks all relatively the same, and that's important because where the block hangs over the edge of the sound hole determines the way that it plays to some degree, and it's important if we're going to compare and contrast different styles of techniques and everything with regards to the distance of the sound holes from the air supply hole and the length of the track. Just tying a knot here. Let's see. Another little loop-de-loo. I don't know if I've ever told you guys why it is we tie these little half knots, half hitch on the back of our flutes. Number one, it's convenient. Number two, it looks kind of neat. Number three, it makes it very convenient if you have somewhere you need to hang your flute up. It's pretty easy. I'm not telling you to rely on that because the weight of the flute may cause it to untie itself, or if you're not as loose, there's a problem in the works. However, that's what we use it for in here in the shop. And this is the medium length, medium distance. And this one pretty much represents the way we normally make flutes. Usually we make the distance between the air supply hole and the sound hole kind of a medium distance, somewhere in a 1-inch marker. That's real common to the way that we make our flutes. And we do it that way, as you will find out in a moment, for a number of reasons. This one is the long distance. We have quite a distance there. So the distance between the top of the air supply hole and the bottom of the sound hole is about 1.5 inches, somewhere around the 37-38 millimeter marker. That's about 1.5 inches. And the length of the track itself looks like it's about the same length as the whole thing on that medium one. The length of the track itself is about 1 inch. So you've got quite a long track there. One thing I'll tell you that's kind of obvious when you've made a good handful of flutes is that the longer track does give you an opportunity to make more mistakes. A shorter track has less mistakes that could be made, and a longer track has an opportunity for more mistakes. One of the mistakes in general would be the depth of the track. A really deep track that is very long would be more of a problem than a really deep track that is very short. A track that has a wobble on it, this one has some imperfections in it right there, you might see. Not really a problem. I sealed them and everything, so they're good. However, if the track is kind of sideways or, you know, has some kind of issue there, it being very long makes that problem even more. So, because there's more problem. Anyway, so, like I say, that's one thing to consider with regards to making a short, medium, or long track. Or a short, medium, or long distance in between the air supply hole and the sound hole. A lot of professional flute makers out there, I'm going to tell you, make a short track or a short distance between the air supply hole and the sound hole. Hey, check it out. This one here is so long, I can tie an extra wrap of leather on it. The medium one has a little bit extra, I'll show you in just a minute, has a little extra space where there could be an extra piece of leather. The short one's just big enough to hold 4 wraps, and this long one has got 5 and has a little room left over. I'll cut this excess leather off. I made it a little too long. And let's go ahead and put our label on it. There we go. So now we have short, medium, and long. That's the distance between the air supply hole under the block and the sound hole. A lot of you probably preferred that I measure this from the center of the sound hole or the center of the air supply hole. I will tell you that where you measure from is something that you need to keep consistent on your own. However, if I measure from the center and tell you to measure from the center, and then you make a flute exactly like I described it to you, it could be a half step sharp, a half step flat, something beyond that. It could sound great, sound better than mine, or not sound at all. And it's dependent on so many different constraints. And that's the reason that I wanted to make this video for you, is because I've made enough flutes. I mean, Jesse and I have made thousands and thousands of flutes. We made hundreds of flutes last week. And with all the flutes that we've made, I've got kind of a knack of making them exactly alike. And after having made so many of them exactly alike, I wanted to be sure that we were able to reproduce everything from the inside of the flutes to the distances and the depths and everything in such a way that would help us rule out the possibility of other things causing it to sound one way or the other. So, I'm going to play the short length one last for a good reason. First, we'll start off with the long one. The long distance between the two, air supply and sound hole, which is, like I say, it's over an inch. It's an inch and a half from one end to the other. There's actually one Native American flute that is a historical representation of our flutes that I have seen that had a track that was about 3 inches long. There's one of those that I've seen in a photograph. And then there's one that I've seen in Mexico that had a track about 3 inches long, and I've seen it in person. It's an amazing flute. So with that in mind, people have been making them that way for a long time. Each of these flutes are going to play a little differently from one to the other. You may decide on one or the other and say, well, that's my kind or that's my kind. I like to make our flutes like the middle one, because you may find people that want it this way or that way, and if we make it in the middle, at least everybody stands a chance of being happy. So this is the long distance. I'll quit talking for a minute. Each of these flutes also tuned out to a B at 432 hertz, by the way. So they tuned out perfectly, just like the book said. Don't forget the book. But anyway, as I'm playing this, I can feel that there's a little back pressure blowing back, and it's because of this length. And that back pressure doesn't make it sound bad. On the microphone, you may hear it sound a little airy, perhaps. What I hear is more of a flute sound, which is great. I've noticed that this particular type of flute with the longer track actually plays a little more mellow than the others. And we'll see what the varying degrees are here. Here is a medium track, medium distance between the air supply and the sound hole. This represents the flutes that we make regularly. You'll notice the tone is a little more clear, it's a little more crisp, and it still sounds like a wooden flute, which is what I really, really prefer to make. A really wonderful sounding flute. Also, once again, like I said, they're all in the key of B, 432 hertz tuned. I just thought we'd go ahead and do it that way for this video. I'm not saying that I prefer one over the other, although B is one of my favorite keys. So this flute, medium length, sounds wonderful. Sounds like a wooden flute. It's what I prefer. It's what I like to make. It's what I've been making. And it also represents a good standpoint on the way that original Native American flutes tracks were made. There was such a varying degree of differences in them. However, on average, they're coming close to this. There are some that are longer and some that are shorter, as we talked. So, a really wonderful flute. I'm going to set him down. This is the one that the camera is going to come out with the clearest sound. The one with the short track, short distance. I mean, it's almost just a hop from the sound hole, from the air supply hole to the sound hole. I mean, it's almost a direct shot from one to the next. This flute is going to be the crispest, clearest sounding flute you're going to like. This flute also represents the way that many flute makers make their flutes. It is not the way that I prefer to make a flute, because it sounds like a tin whistle. It sounds like a metal instrument rather than a wooden instrument. And having been a brass player, grew up in high school playing marching band, I mean, gosh, we were in parades all over the United States. I know what a brass sounding instrument is. Brassy is what they call an instrument when it's too hard and brash, when it's too crisp. It's so crisp that it's almost playing another note. You know what I'm saying? So I'll play it for you. I like it. Don't get me wrong. It sounds wonderful. It's just not the way that I like to make flutes. Not putting down any other flute makers, because we get people say, I want the clearest sounding flute you can make. And I still usually make them one with that M on it instead of the one with the S on it here. However, the S does sound really good. Very brassy, and may actually cause people that think that high-tone flutes hurt their ears may actually be inclined to do so. So, whereas I could play this flute for someone, they would say, well, that sounds really mellow. And this one is like, oh, that's really mellow. You know, that's a really mellow sounding flute. And that one's just too high for me to hear. They're all the same key. And they sound a little different from one another because of the way that we made the track. So I hope that answers a question for you guys. It's not really important if you make it an inch between the sound hole and air supply hole, an inch and a quarter, 3 inches, or a little almost quarter of an inch. The thing that's important is that you practice and find the way that works best for you and take it from there. Myself, I prefer to make them, like I said, about an inch from top to bottom, and you can see that on most of our flutes. They're almost all identical until you get to the small ones. They're almost always at the same distance. This one's not finished yet. I guess that was a bad example. Sorry, guys. So here's a red one here. He's not finished either, but you still get the idea. They're about the same distance, every one of them. So once again, I hope this has helped you guys to answer that age-old question of what distance should I have between the center of the sound hole and the air supply hole, or how long should my track be, and that kind of thing. And we have some other videos that'll be dealing with this kind of thing very soon. I know you're going to enjoy them, so please watch out for them. We have some very unusual and interesting videos coming up, too, that are still being processed. I hope you guys have enjoyed it. If you have any questions, feel free to shoot us an email at our website, bluebearflutes.com, or you can also contact us on Facebook, as well as Instagram and YouTube and everything in the world. I mean, I don't know how many other ways we can contact you, but I hope you've enjoyed the video, and thank you very much again for watching us. Take care, happy flute playing and flute making, and we'll talk to you really soon.